Good morning. Let's sing together.
Brethren, we have met to worship. Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray, and holy manna will be showered all around. Brethren, see poor sinners round you, stumbling on the brink of woe. Death is coming, hell is moving, can you bear to let them go? See our fathers and our mothers and our children sinking down. Brethren, pray, and holy manna will be showered all around. Love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new. Then He'll call us home to heaven. At His table we'll sit down. Christ will gird Himself and serve us with sweet manna all around.
You can be seated.
Well, good morning. Come on in. Welcome to Redeemer Community Church. We are glad that the Lord has brought you our way this morning. So let's open in a word of prayer. Father, we come together this morning to lift up our eyes and our hearts to You, for You are the God of heaven and earth. Lord, we ask that You would stir in us as we seek to take hold of You, as we seek Your face. Lord, we want to give You glory, the glory due Your name, for You are our God. We thank You, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, again, welcome. Thank you for being here, and if you are a guest, we want to extend to you a special welcome and tell you that you can fill one of these out for us if you would. Maybe you got one when came in the door if you were an unfamiliar face. I know we have several guests with us this morning, some folks I've already met. And by the way, if you're a regular attender here and you see an unfamiliar face, make sure and greet them. Maybe you'll meet somebody that's been here a while that you just didn't know before, or they may be a guest. I think I've maybe told this story before, but very briefly, when we had moved to Dallas, first time we went to visit a church, about to walk out the door after the service, and nobody had said a word to us. Walking down the hallway, and a lady stopped and said, "Hi, I'm Tina Cobb. What's your name?" I still remember her name. And we ended up joining that church. That one lady made the difference in greeting us. So I just say that to encourage you to greet and give a warm welcome to those. So anyway, all that being said, if you're a visitor, we'd love you to fill one of these out. And on the back, you can give us your information. You can put your email address on there. We'd send you our church newsletter that we just send out once a week, and you can find out what's going on here and learn more about Redeemer Community Church. And if you do that, put that in what for our regular attenders is the giving box in that corner back there. That's all we ask you to do for us. We don't expect you to put anything else in there, and ask that you really not. So we'd love to know about you. So thank you for being here. And right next to that's the prayer request box. avail yourself of that means of grace. The church leadership would love to pray for you if you've got something that we can lift up before the throne of grace for you. A couple of things. First of all, today is the third Sunday. So remember, first and third, Super Sunday's the word, okay? It's third Sunday, it's Super Sunday, so 5 through 8 year olds, right after the worship set and we finish singing, you're going to meet the Neffs back in the lobby there, and they're going to take you back with a special lesson just for you. Do that, and also the new member class will resume this week. You know, we took last week off for Mother's Day. Right after church, meet back in the Hall of Mirrors, lunch and child care provided. So that will continue. And I think that's it as far as announcements. You know, this morning we're going to continue our study about the Holy Spirit. Bob's going to lead us and teach us from that. And today he's going to teach us about the gifts that we receive as the children of God, that we receive from the Holy Spirit. He gives us all gifts. So to help point us in that direction before we sing, we're going to read together from Romans 12, verses 4 through 8. So let's all stand together and let's read that, and then we'll worship in song. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Let us use them, if prophecy, in proportion to our faith, if service, in our serving, the one who teaches, in his teaching, the one who exhorts, in his exhortation, the one who contributes, in generosity, the one who leads, with zeal, and the one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness.
We're going to sing a wonderful Trinitarian hymn written by Charles Wesley. The text is from Wesley. The tune is from an Italian composer, Felice de Giardini, and we're actually going to meddle with his melody a little bit. Actually, the rhythm is a little different than the way he wrote it. So if you hear us slowing down where you're used to singing fast, you'll catch on to kind of how we do this rhythm as we do it. This is the wonderful hymn, Come Thou Almighty King.
Come thou, almighty King, help us thy name to sing, help us to praise. Father, all glorious, o'er all victorious, come and reign over us, Ancient of Days. Come thou, incarnate Word, gird on thy mighty sword, our prayer attend. Come and thy people bless, and give thy word success, Spirit of holiness, on us descend. Come, Holy Comforter, thy sacred witness bear, in this glad hour. Thou who almighty art, now rule in every heart, and ne'er from us depart, Spirit of power. One in three, eternal praises be, hence evermore. Thy sovereign majesty may we in glory see, and to eternity love and adore. Thank you.
led her to mercy alone. Of covenant mercy I sing. I come with your righteousness on, my humble offering to bring. The judgments of your holy law with me can have nothing to do. My Savior's obedience and blood hide all my transgressions from you. The work which your goodness began, the arm of your strength will complete. Your promise is yes and amen, and never was forfeited yet. The future of things that are now, no power below or above can make you your purpose forego, or sever my soul from your love. My name on the palms of your hands, eternity will not erase. Impressed on your heart it remains, in marks of indelible grace. Yes, I to the end will endure, until I bow down at your throne, forever and always secure, debtor to mercy. Seated. We want to pause at this point in our service and confess together our sin before the Lord. Would you bow and let's pray together? Father, we worship you this morning as the God of wisdom. It was by your wisdom that the world was made. You order all of nature and all of history by your wisdom. You work all things according to your holy will. And you order our lives by your wisdom. You bring into our lives exactly the right combination of joys and sorrows, of trials and blessings, to shape us into the image of your beloved Son. And Lord, we pause here to confess that we lack wisdom. We confess we do not seek wisdom as we ought. And that even when we know what is the right thing to do, we often choose to act foolishly. We confess that we often prefer to trust the wisdom of the world instead of the wisdom that we find in your word. We want to define for ourselves what is good and what's evil when it comes to relationships or speech or our work or our sexuality. We fail to love others as we ought. You have brought into our lives instead of trusting in you and delighting in your fatherly wisdom, trusting that you're doing all that you do for our good and for your glory. And Lord, as we pause here in this minute, we ask that you by your Spirit might bring to our hearts and minds any specific sin that we need to confess before you this morning. Jesus, we thank you that you lived a life full of wisdom. You trusted perfectly in your heavenly Father. You always obeyed. You responded with wisdom in every situation, every relationship. You gave gentle answers when that was appropriate. You spoke convicting words when necessary, and you held your peace when that was the wisest response. You never complained about your Father's will for your life. even though it meant learning obedience through suffering. And in the end, you paid the penalty for our sin, even through the wisdom of the cross, you accomplished your Father's plan to redeem us. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would teach us to seek after wisdom passionately. Wisdom is your gift. Give us hearts that desire it and pursue it. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. And now if you'd stand and receive these words of assurance, the good news of the gospel that our sins are forgiven by a gracious and merciful God. If you are in Christ, God declares that you are his treasured possession, that he loves you, and is keeping the oath that he swore to your fathers. By his grace, you've been redeemed from the house of slavery, and your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
O mighty cross,
love lifted high,
the Lord of life,
raised there to die,
his sacrifice on Calvary has made the mighty cross a tree of life to me. O mighty cross, what throne of grace! He knew no sin, yet took my place. His sacrifice on Calvary has made the mighty cross a tree of life to me. O mighty cross, O God so pure, love held him there, such shame endured. His sacrifice on Calvary has made the mighty cross a tree of life to me. Cross, my soul's release, the stripes he bore have brought me peace. His sacrifice on Calvary has made the mighty cross a tree of life to me. His sacrifice on Calvary has made the mighty cross a tree of life to me.
Father, we worship you this morning. We pray that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart would be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. You can be seated. Those of you who are 5 through 8, you can head to the back for Super Sunday, and everybody else can stand back up and greet the folks around you. Say hi to the folks who are new here this morning. Okay, let's go ahead and find a seat. If you have your Bible with you, and I hope you brought it this morning, I want you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians 12 is where we're going to be. I told you when we started this series on the Holy Spirit 5 weeks ago. Remember, next Sunday is Pentecost, and so we're leading up to the celebration of the coming of the Spirit at Pentecost with this series on the Holy Spirit. And I told you when we started that there was a whole lot about the Holy Spirit that we don't know, and then there is what God has revealed to us, and we only understand a portion of what God's revealed to us, and I only understand a portion of what we understand. So when you get right down to it, there's only a little bit that I understand, but it would take a lot of weeks to get through all of that. I mean, the subject of the Holy Spirit is pretty immense. And the subject we're going to talk about this morning, the subject of spiritual gifts, there's, again, a lot we don't know, and there's some stuff that we do know and some stuff that we don't agree on, and I only got 45 minutes. So we're going to try and zero in on what we can focus on as we look at the gifts of the Spirit, the subject about spiritual gifts. And I'll just say at the beginning, if you came this morning with questions about the subject of spiritual gifts, you're not alone, because I have some. And if you leave and your questions haven't been answered, I won't be surprised, okay? Because there's just so much to cover that we can't get to all of it this morning. But hopefully in the time that we have, we can give an overview on the subject of spiritual gifts and talk about some of the issues that are there. And I'll begin with a great quote from Martin Lloyd-Jones on this subject. He said, "There are a lot of very debatable questions, and you will know that there are authorities on both sides of these issues, and invariably that's the case with difficult matters." He said, "But I suggest to you humbly in this regard that we cannot arrive at finality with regard to these questions in this life." Okay, so it's just good to know that this is one of those things that we're not going to settle this side of heaven, some of the debates on the gifts of the Spirit. And what that means is that we got to figure out how we sharpen iron with one another, how we dialogue about this in grace, in kindness, in love with one another, not dividing fellowship over these issues, unless somebody's drifting off into heresy, and we'll talk about some of that this morning. But we need to leave room. It's fine for you to have a view, but you need to leave room and grace for folks who would have a different view. That ought to be okay with us. It ought to be okay that if God has not been clear and specific on some of the questions we have, we either don't need to be asking those questions, or we need to be comfortable with the ambiguity of it all. So we're going to do our best to try to be careful as we dig into this and not get dogmatic on things that we shouldn't get dogmatic on. There are really four passages in Scripture that deal with spiritual gifts. We read one this morning, the passage from Romans chapter 12. Spiritual gifts are listed in there. 1 Peter has one verse that lists spiritual gifts. And in Ephesians chapter 4, there's one verse that talks about he gave apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists. Those are either offices or gifts or some combination. And then you get to this section of 1 Corinthians chapters 12, 13, and 14. And that's really the broadest treatment on the subject of spiritual gifts that you find in the Bible. And we're going to read together through the whole chapter of 1 Corinthians 12. But before we read God's word, it's our custom to ask him to give us ears to hear and eyes to see. So pray with me as we ask, Lord, that you would hear our cry this morning. We need to hear your voice. Give us ears to hear what your spirit would say to your church from this portion of your word. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bible, follow along with me. I'm going to be reading from the English Standard Version, beginning at verse 1 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul writes, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, I don't want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to mute idols, however you were led. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says Jesus is accursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good." Just mark that verse. We're going to come back to that. "For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportions to each one individually as he wills. For just as the body is one and has many members, all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, were all made to drink of one Spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members of the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the hand to the feet, or the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And on those parts of the body that we think less honorable, we bestow the greatest honor, and our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Now, you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administering, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healings? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the higher gifts. And I'll show you a still more excellent way. May God add his blessing to this reading of his word. Amen. So let me start this morning with a little gift-giving advice, since we're talking about gifts. And this, by the way, is for mostly for younger husbands, all right? Because if anybody makes gift-giving errors, it is typically husbands in the first 5 to 10 years of marriage. Sometimes it continues beyond that, but often in the first 5 to 10. And us older husbands, we can give younger husbands advice because we've made most of these gifts. Whether you have an occasion in front of you, maybe it's a birthday, maybe it's Christmas, an anniversary coming up, a wedding celebration, Valentine's Day, or any other day that your wife deems should be a gift-giving holiday, okay? She has the right to declare any day. It can be the anniversary of your first date. That may be deemed by your wife a gift-giving holiday. You need to respond to that. If that's the case, there's some rules you should keep in mind. Okay, here's the first rule. Do not give a gift card, and particularly not a gift card to Home Depot, to your wife for an anniversary. This will not go well. And worse than a gift card is to give her cash. Okay, do not give her cash. And you may think, well, that's pretty obvious. We're going to show a clip here. If we can dim the lights and pull the clip over. We're going to show a clip. You may remember this from Seinfeld when Jerry gave Elaine cash. So watch this, all right? Can we watch?
Maybe you won't like it.
Oh, how could I not like it? Of course I'll like it.
You could not like it.
Just the fact that you remembered means everything.
Of course I remembered. You reminded me every day for 2 months. Oh, the card.
Cash?
What do you think?
You got me cash?
Well, that's right. You can go out and get yourself whatever you want. No good?
Are you my uncle?
Hey, come on. It's $182 there. I don't think that's anything to sneeze at.
Okay, we'll leave it there. I just want you to know he goes and gets a card, and it gets worse when he gives her the card, okay? Because he calls her his pal in the card, all right? So, guys, cash, gift cards, that's number one. Number two, exercise equipment and scales. Not good gift ideas to give to your wife for an anniversary, okay? You send kind of the wrong message with that. Number three, unless she has specifically requested an appliance, do not go the appliance route. Blenders are not good, okay? Toaster ovens are not good. Vacuums are particularly bad ideas for appliance gifts. If the gift is something that you found at Walgreens or Walmart late at night the night before, it's probably going to be a bad thing, okay? You probably can't score a great gift at Walgreens the night before the event. And do not give her something that you really want, okay? Golf clubs and the big screen TV are not what she's looking for as a special gift, all right? Now, obviously, when we give gifts to one another, our goal in giving the gifts is to say, I love you, I appreciate you, I've been thinking about you, I wanted you to have something special, here's a rifle for you, I hope you like it. No, he gives each recruit the gift that he's giving them because there's work to do, there's an assignment, and they're going to need this gift for their part in what he's calling them to do. God gives spiritual gifts to his children for the same purpose. It's not a sweet token of his appreciation. It is a giving of gifting because there's a job to do, and you're going to need the gifts God gives you to accomplish your part in what he's called all of us together to accomplish. That makes sense? So I'm going to try to answer for us this morning 8 questions related to the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And if you'll pop that up, here are the questions we're going to try to tackle this morning. We'll talk, first of all, what exactly is a spiritual gift? Secondly, what's the main purpose for spiritual gifts? Number three, what gifts are on the gift list? Number four, does every Christian have a spiritual gift? Number five, how can I know if I have one? And if I do, how can I know what it is? Number six, should I desire the gifts I don't have? Number seven, is there a relationship between having a spiritual gift and being spiritually mature? And then the last question is, have some of the gifts ceased? So I did sneak in that one at the end, okay? We'll get there before we're done. Now, obviously, if we're going to try to tackle all 8 of those questions, we're not going to be able to go too deep on any of them. but we'll try to skate across the top and hopefully answer some questions. And in the past few weeks in this series, I put the verses up on the screen because we looked at a lot of verses. This morning, I'm not doing that because I want you looking at your Bible. I want you underlining stuff. I want you highlighting stuff as we go through it, whether it's on your phone or your tablet or in your lap. I just want you digging this out for yourself. So let's talk about what a spiritual gift is first, okay? What exactly is a spiritual gift? And for the definition of that, rather than looking at Romans or at 1 Corinthians 12, where we've been, flip back some pages to Romans chapter 1. Romans 1, and look at verse 10, 11. Is it 11? Paul says, I long to see you. Where is that? That verse 11? Okay. Chapter 1, verse 11. Paul says, I long to see you that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you. Now, let me stop there. Paul is not saying, I'm the giver of gifts. So I'm coming with a bag of gifts and I'm going to impart them to you. That's not what that word impart means. Paul is saying, I'm coming and my desire is to use the spiritual gifts God's given me. I want to impart the blessing of that gift to strengthen you. And then he says, that is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both yours and mine. So a spiritual gift is some spirit-empowered ability where God uses you in the lives of others to strengthen them in their walk of faith. And as a result, both of you are encouraged in that process. The person who uses this gift, there's joy in knowing that your gifts have been received and used to advance the kingdom. And the person who's the beneficiary, there's joy in the receiving and knowing that you've been blessed by somebody else's gifting. John Piper talks about spiritual gifts this way. He says, a spiritual gift is an expression of faith which aims to strengthen faith. It is activated from faith in us, and it aims for faith in another. Another way to put this would be, are we still there? Yeah. Another way to put this would be, a spiritual gift is an ability given by the Holy Spirit to express our faith effectively in word or deed for the strengthening of someone else's faith. So whatever your spiritual gift is, whatever anyone's spiritual gift is, its purpose is to strengthen the faith of others through the use of that gift. Look back at 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and look at verse 7, the verse I told you we were going to come back to. Paul says, to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for what? The common good. People will say, well, the purpose of tongues, the purpose of this personal prayer language is to edify yourself. Well, that doesn't seem to be the purpose for any of these gifts, according to what the scriptures say. Now, the reason people will say, well, I think it is for personal edification is because in 1 Corinthians 14, look a couple chapters ahead, Paul says, the one who speaks in a tongue builds himself up, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. You see that verse? What verse is that?
Four.
Verse 4, okay. Now, so people read that and say, see there, tongues is for personal edification. No, Paul is not saying you speak in tongues to edify yourself. He's saying when you speak in this language that you're speaking in, nobody's being edified but you. And that's not a good thing. So he's not commending tongues for personal edification. He's saying tongues aren't any good unless they're being used to edify the whole body through the gift of interpretation coming with it. Now, I probably just raised a whole bunch of questions, right? And we can't dive down into those, but we'll move on and see if we can get to some of the others here. So when you've been given a gift from God, that gift is given for the edification of others, the edification of the church. When a soldier gets his rifle from the supply sergeant, he should not go away and go, cool, I got a rifle, now I can go out and shoot whenever I want. If a guy does that in the army, what happens? They take his rifle away. That's not why they gave him a rifle, to go shoot whenever he wants. When Benjamin Buchanan, who's here, who's in the Air Force, when they give him a plane and say, here, you can go fly, he doesn't say, cool, I can go take this out, maybe out for a spin anytime I want, right? The plane is not for him. It's not for his edification. It's to serve a greater purpose. And he uses his plane, the soldier uses his rifle under the direction of the commanding officer for the purpose for which it was given, which is for the battle that's in front of them. Your spiritual gifts are the same. God gives them to you, not primarily for your strengthening, although the use of them will strengthen you. He gives them to you because it's to edify the body for a higher purpose. Okay, here's a second thing we need to know about spiritual gifts. What is the main purpose of spiritual gifts? Oh, we just talked about that. Okay, I didn't get the second. So that's the main purpose, the edification of the body. Here's the third thing. Is there a list of spiritual gifts? I told you there are four passages. There's the one in 1 Corinthians 12. There's one verse in 1 Peter 4, verse 11. Ephesians 4, verse 11, and then this passage. And here's the thing. There are different lists in different places. So I conclude from that there's not one standard list. It's not like God's got 15 of them, and he forgot a few in this chapter and forgot a few in this chapter. What I'm concluding from that is that anything can qualify as a spiritual gift when you are serving others in the power of the Holy Spirit and others are being edified. That's the utilization of a spiritual gift. There may be things you do that cause that to happen that aren't on the lists, and they would still qualify as a spiritual gift. Now, the great thing about the lists is that you can look at the list and say, I wonder if any of these belong to me. It's kind of a help to get you started. But my thesis here is that anything you're doing to serve others in the power of the Holy Spirit, where God is at work in the midst of that and others are being edified, that's the utilization of a spiritual giftedness. In fact, I would encourage people not to spend so much time asking the question, I wonder what my gift is, but we all ought to be asking the question, how can I serve others? Because if you figure out how you can serve others, you'll figure out what your gift is. People get all, yeah, I wonder if I'm this and what's my personality and what's it? That's okay, but a lot of people get paralyzed because they're not sure what their spiritual gift is. You don't have to be sure about anything. Just use your desires, your talents, your abilities in service for others in the power of the Spirit. And in that process, if others are edified, that's a sign that you're using a spiritual gift. Okay? So the next thing, what gifts are on the list? Does every Christian have a spiritual gift? Look again at verse 7 of 1 Corinthians 12. To each is given a manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Each means each. That means everybody's got one of these. In fact, look down at verse 13. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. There is this picture that this is the same. There's one Spirit. He does a work in all of us. It's a different work, but it's one Spirit, and it's true for all of us. So everybody is given a spiritual endowment, a spiritual empowering by God. And I would suggest to you that spiritual empowering is also not necessarily a specific gift. It may be a gift mix. You're probably familiar with Ephesians 2:10, where his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which he did what? Prepared for us beforehand, that we should walk in them. Well, when God was preparing the path that you're going to walk in beforehand, God figured out, let's see, what is Chris going to need here? And then God took a gift mix, I believe, where he said, he's going to need some of this, he's going to need a little bit of this, he's going to need some of that, and he customized a spiritual gift that he gave to Chris and said, here's what you're going to need to accomplish. Just like God gives Benjamin the airplane and a soldier a rifle because it's different, God may give some soldiers a rifle and a canteen because they're going to need the canteen too. So I think it's an amalgamation, not just a single boxy linear kind of gifting. And there are a lot of commentaries that will make the point that there's a difference between a spiritual endowment and your talents, your natural talents and your abilities. And they'll say, don't get this mixed up. A spiritual gift is not the same as a talent. And I would say I agree with that. But I would also say God might spiritually endow a talent you have and turn it into a spiritual gift. Just because you're talented in an area doesn't mean you're disqualified to be gifted in that same area. So somebody who comes to faith in Christ at age 40, and that person has always been a very effective classroom teacher, we should not say, well, God's not going to give that guy the gift of teaching because that's already a talent he's got. God might spiritually empower his teaching ability and turn it into a spiritual gift. So the question is, well, how do I know if I'm using a talent or if I'm using a spiritual gift? Well, here's how you know. First of all, are you relying on the ministry of the Spirit in your life to do what you're doing, or are you doing it on the backstroke? I mean, those of you who are gifted and talented in certain areas, you know there's some things you can do just because you're good at them, right? You don't need any spiritual help on this. I got this. That's not a spiritual gift, right? In order for you to be functioning in the power of the Holy Spirit, you've got to recognize your reliance. I had to recognize before I got up here this morning that no matter how glib I am, unless the Holy Spirit, we sang it in the first hymn we sang, all is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. What I'm doing is fruitless unless the Holy Spirit's energizing it. I have to recognize my dependence on that before any ability I have can be a gifting. And then beyond that, I have to see whether or not it's causing edification in the lives of others. If I'm flapping my gums and you're not being edified, then there's no gifting happening there. The Spirit is good at this. He accomplishes his purposes. So spiritual giftedness means that if you are serving dependent on the Spirit and others are being edified, whether it was a natural ability or not, that's a Spirit endowment in your life that you couldn't do apart from his work. There are people you'll meet, for example, who are not natural leaders. You see, this is the case where somebody is maybe not talented or gifted in a particular area, but the Spirit comes on them and they become great leaders in a particular setting, or they just, you can tell, they're empowered in the church to do leading, but at work they just would never get there. That can be a spiritual endowment where you'd see somebody who lacks a talent or a gift, but God spiritually imbues him with that. So it can be a talent or a gift. It doesn't have to be. God may give you an ability that is foreign to you as a part of your spiritual gift mix. In fact, I want you to look at an example of this in Acts chapter 4. So flip over to Acts chapter 4, back toward the Gospels. In Acts chapter 4, Peter and John have been brought before the high priests and the scribes and the rulers and the elders, and they have been asked questions. Verse 7 of Acts chapter 4 says, "When they had set them in the midst, they inquired, 'By what power or by what name do you do this?'" Now, what's the this? Well, you have to look back. They've been testifying about Jesus, and this is also the place where Peter came up to the man who was crippled at the gate, and the guy says, "You got any money?" And Peter says, "I don't have any silver or gold, but what I have I'll give you in the name of Christ. Rise, be healed." So now the scribes, Pharisees said, where did that come from? By what power do you do this? Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we're being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well." So Peter understands, I didn't have any special healing ability. This was all Jesus. "Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone, and there's salvation in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." Now look at verse 13. "When they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished." Peter was not an educated fisherman. Okay, he had never studied the scriptures. Here he is quoting the Old Testament, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. He just healed a guy. And they're going, this is not some simple fisherman. Where did this guy get this? And what's the answer? He was filled with and gifted by the Holy Spirit to accomplish what is happening here. So this is an example of spiritual giftedness at work in the life of Peter. You may have experienced this. Somebody comes and asks you a question, and you give them an answer, and then you go, "How did I think of that?" Have you ever had that happen? Where somebody said, and you give counsel and you look back and go, "Ed, I don't know where that came from." It was a wisdom beyond yourself that God gave you in the moment. That's a spiritual gifting. You may have had a situation where you came into a place that was in some kind of crisis. There was just, things were not going well. And you said, "Hang on, let me help." And you got in and you said, "Lord, help me here." And you started working, you got things organized and helped, and everything smoothed out and it all, and you got done with that and you smiled and everybody came up and said, "Thank you so much." That could be your natural ability, but it can also be a case where you just know God just used me in that moment. Because I wasn't planning that. I just knew what I had to do and I went and did it. That's how we know spiritual gifting is going on. Well, the answer to how you can know if you're accomplishing spiritual giftedness, back at what we said in Romans 1, it's that idea that if your gift is strengthening others, if they are being encouraged and built up, then it's probably a spiritual gifting area for you. Let me just say here too, a lot of times when we give to the gifts of preaching and teaching, which are listed in what we read here, there are a lot of times you get to those gifts, and by the way, I think those are two different gifts. Teaching is when somebody can help you understand the scriptures, can help you understand the things of God. Preaching is somebody, or when somebody, I think it always includes teaching, but when somebody takes truth and tries to press it to your soul and urges you to act and live differently, that's preaching. So I'm teaching if I help you understand something, but I'm preaching if I start meddling, okay? Meddling is preaching, and they're two different gifts. But a lot of people will have this, you have a love for God's word, you have been blessed by the ministry of preachers or teachers, you've so benefited from that, and you desire to want to do that in the lives of others, and you think, I've been blessed by a preacher, I want to be a preacher. Well, it's possible that you have that desire, but you don't have the gift. And here's how you know if you have the gift. Preach some and see if anybody benefits, okay? As long as people are benefiting, keep preaching. But if you have a Bible study and people quit coming, you probably don't have the gift of teaching. And that can, you may be sad that you don't have the gift of teaching, but you have to stop and ask the question, why am I sad? Is it because you wanted the esteem or the recognition that goes with being a preacher or a teacher? Or is it because you really felt you had that gift and somehow that's not being confirmed? There's a healthy warning, by the way, in James chapter 3 that says not all of you, not many of you should become teachers because there's a stricter judgment engaged. So, and James gives that warning, by the way, because as I'm up here preaching this morning, I just got to be aware I'm going to stand before God one day, give account for what I said. If he said, well, where did you come up with that, right? If I'm not representing Christ accurately, I got to be careful. Now, I'm not perfect. I'm infallible. God gives grace. I am fallible. I'm not infallible. Thank you. God gives grace in the midst of that. But there ought to be a holy fear that comes anytime you preach or you teach, knowing you're representing the Word of God, the person of God, in the midst of this. And that's something you should not covet or desire unless it's really clear that God has gifted you there. So figuring out what is your gift, I think Rick Warren is really helpful here. Let me see if I got his. He talks about your shape, and he says, here's how you can kind of get an idea of what God made you to do. First of all, what are your spiritual gifts? What spiritual abilities do you use that God blesses? Then he says, what's your heart? What do you have a passion for? What do you love to do? Then he says, how about your abilities? What natural talents or skills do you have? What about your personality? What does your personality set you to do? And then what experiences has God given you? Painful experiences, educational experiences, ministry experiences? He says, these five areas help you determine what it is God wants you to do. And I think they all fit into that general rubric of what is the spiritual endowment that God's given you to use for others. So spiritual gifts, heart, abilities, personalities, and experiences. Rick Warren says, your ministry will be most effective and fulfilling when you're using your gifts and abilities in the area of your heart's desire in a way that expresses your personality and your experience. You want to know what God's called you to do? Use the gifts and abilities that he's given you in the power of the Holy Spirit in an area that you desire that expresses your personality and your experiences. And God will use that. You might think, I don't really have any special gifts or abilities. Ask the people who know you best to tell you, where do you think I'm spiritually gifted? Where do you think I have ability? Where do you think it would be best for me to be used for kingdom work? Other people may know better than you what those things are. All right? So here's our next question. Should you desire certain spiritual gifts? Now, some have suggested that we should desire specific gifts, and they get this from the end of chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where it says, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, do all work miracles, do all possess gifts of healings, do all speak with tongues? What's the implied answer to each one of those questions? No. No, no. But then it says, do all interpret? Earnestly desire the higher gifts. Well, there it says, we should earnestly desire higher gifts. Well, first of all, what are the higher gifts? Well, I think the issue of higher gifts, if the purpose of spiritual gifts is to build up the church, then the higher gifts are the ones that build up the church most. So you can ask, what's a higher gift, by asking what, and in some moments, some gifts will be higher than others. There are times when preaching's not the right thing to do. That would not be the higher gift when you've come to console a widow on the death of her husband. That's when the gift of mercy needs to kick in, right? So the higher gifts are set by the moment, but you should desire what's going to edify the most people, what's going to advance the kingdom the most. Those are the higher gifts. And then the question is, should all of us earnestly desire those gifts? Should everybody desire to be a teacher, a preacher, an apostle, a prophet? No, I think what Paul is saying in these verses is we as the church should earnestly desire that those higher gifts are at use among us. When he says earnestly desire the higher gifts, he's not saying you as an individual should desire that you have that gift. He's saying you as a church should desire that that gift is present among you and that it's in use among you and that it's prioritized among you. In fact, that's what he goes on to say in chapter 14 when he talks about prophecy and tongues. And he says prophecy is better than tongues because prophecy serves more people. Prophecy is a higher gift than tongues. That whole chapter is about the superiority of prophecy over the gift of tongues. Two reasons why I think Paul is not saying that you should desire specific gifts. First of all, we've already read that the Holy Spirit is sovereign over whom he gifts. Look back at verse 11 of 1 Corinthians 12. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportions to each one individually as he wills. The Holy Spirit decides what you get. And then look at verse 18. God arranges the members in the body, each of them, as he chose. There's God at work in the midst of us. He's deciding it's up to him. So I don't think we should be desiring what he's already decided is the right thing. But there's a second reason. We shouldn't seek after gifts because, I think it's coveting, by the way, but beyond it being coveting, if all of us had all of the gifts, who wouldn't we need? Each other. If I had all the gifts, I could go check out, wouldn't need fellowship with you, wouldn't need any of it. But as it is, I am dependent on you, and you're dependent on me for this process that God's got us in to grow us into Christ-likeness. I can't get there on my own. I need people who are gifted differently than me to use their gifts in my life in order to help me get there. And you need people like that in your life as well. So we should earnestly desire the gifts being used in our midst, particularly the higher gifts that will benefit the most people and will cause the most growth. But we should not covet that we would have all the gifts. Most of us, most of the things on the gift list are things that all of us are called to do, by the way, at some level, like the gift of helps. You can't walk into a place where help is needed and go, well, it's not my gift, right? You know, when your wife says, hey, could you help with the dish? No, it's not my gift, right? That's not going to go well for you, okay? And or some people are gifted as evangelists. Everybody called to be an evangelist? Yes. Are some people gifted in that way? Yes. Now, you can't back down from sharing Christ with others because you don't have that gift. No, we're all called to do the things that are on these lists, but some of us are gifted spiritually to do those things. Those who are gifted spiritually operate in your giftedness. Those who aren't, keep doing what you're called to do, whether it's your gift or not. I watched a video this week of a young man who is passionate about evangelism. I don't know if he has the gift of evangelism, but he certainly has a passion for it. And passion is an indicator that he might have a gift. It's not a certainty, but it's an indicator. But I can't go away from watching that video and thinking, well, good, that guy's got that covered. I'm off the hook. We all have to teach at times. We all have to evangelize at times. We all have to show hospitality at times, et cetera, et cetera. You're not off the hook just because you don't have the gift. And let me get to this next thing. I hope this is clear. The relationship between spiritual gifts and spiritual maturity, the possession of certain spiritual gifts does not make somebody more spiritually mature than somebody who has different gifts. We should not equate spiritual giftedness and spiritual maturity. I have met gifted Bible teachers who are spiritually immature, and they are dangerous. Okay? You may be given a gift, but you may not have the spiritual maturity to be exercising that well, which is why at the end of this chapter on spiritual gifts, Paul says, let me show you the more excellent way. And then what's he talk about in 13? Love. He talks about character. He talks about the fruit of the Spirit in your life. Rather than seeking gifts, you should be seeking godly character, because the operation of your gifts will go better if you have godly character through which that's being operated. A person who lacks godly character but is spiritually gifted is a dangerous person. So if you have a spiritual gift but you lack godly character, pray for godly character. If you have godly character, pray for more. That should be our focus. Martin Lloyd-Jones here makes a compelling point. He says, if the argument is that low spirituality means the absence of gifts and high spirituality means the presence of gifts, how did it ever come to pass that there were any gifts in the church at Corinth, which is one of the least spiritual of the New Testament churches? 1 Corinthians 13 is all about how it's more important to have love than gifts, and it can be dangerous for spiritually immature people to try to use their gifts. That, by the way, is why God, when he sets out the list of qualifications for church leaders, for elders and deacons, and for 1 Timothy 3 and in Titus chapter 1, the focus in that list of qualifications is mostly on character. Apt to teach is in there, but it's not all about their giftedness. It's about their character. Because godly leadership in the church requires godly character more than godly giftedness. Now, I've saved the big question here for the end. Have some of the gifts ceased? Are there some gifts that were used during the early years of the church that are no longer needed and, as a result, no longer being given out by the Holy Spirit? I told Marianne I was going to talk about this week, and she said, well, what's your answer? And I said, well, what's your answer? And she said, I don't want to go there. Okay? Right? Who does? This is a divisive, polarizing issue. We've got to be careful. Let me go back to what Martin Lloyd-Jones said. There are authorities on either side. Invariably, as the case with difficult matters, we've got to humbly regard we're not going to come to finality on this. So, as we explore this, we've got to leave room for, I'll tell you kind of what I think's going on, but I'm going to tell you that I have great respect for people who have a different view. So, there are people who I trust and respect who believe that certain of the spiritual gifts, we call them the miraculous or the sign gifts, typically healing, miracles, tongues. Sometimes they will include, they often include apostleship and prophecy. This gets tricky because there may be a difference between the office of an apostle and a prophet and the gifting. At some level, preaching is prophecy, but it's a different kind of prophecy than the apostles had. At some level, anybody who goes forth to plant churches is an apostle. They're acting as an apostle, but they're not the same as the 12. So it gets a little tricky and squishy. You dive in here, and there's just some confusion around all of this. But there are men who I respect and admire who believe that some of these miraculous gifts, healing, tongue, prophecy, some of the others, they're gone. John MacArthur would be a leading guy in this regard. Most Southern Baptists, I think this is the official theological position of Dallas Seminary and Moody Bible Institute, that these gifts have ceased. These people are called, do I have it here? Cessationists, okay? They believe certain gifts have ceased. Now, there's a second group. They're called the cautious but open group. This is how John Piper describes himself. He says, I don't know, I've seen enough abuse among the charismatic movement that I'm a little wary of, well, I'm a lot wary, because there's a lot going on in the name of the Holy Spirit that's not the Holy Spirit. So he says, with great caution, I'm open to the fact that these gifts may be employed in our world today. And John Piper would tell you about people coming back from third world countries who did miraculous things where there were healings or where there were ability to speak in a language that people did not know. And he would say, I don't know how to explain that, so I'm open to the fact that there may be a gifting here. And then there's a third group, the continuationist. Matt Chandler would be in that group. Now, I put three really good guys up there, didn't I? I love all three of those guys. I have learned a lot from all three of those guys. And they don't agree on this. And they love one another and they can fellowship with one another. Well, sometimes they, you know, the fellowship gets a little heated, but that's okay. They respect one another because they all agree on the gospel. They've all got the core stuff right, and they say, you know what, we can disagree on this, and it may be a heated disagreement, but we can still fellowship and love one another. We should not break fellowship over this. I'll just point out at the Village Church in Dallas, here's what their official statement says. All the gifts of the Holy Spirit are at work in the church of the first century, that were at work in the church of the first century, are available today and are to be earnestly desired and practiced. They're essential in the mission of the church and in the world today. Okay, that's their official position. So, who's right? MacArthur, Piper, or Chandler? Okay, I'm not as smart as any of them. So anything I would say, I'd have to acknowledge they're smarter and have probably looked at this harder than me. And so the answer to who's right is you got me. But I'll say this. And I wish I had time to explain why I believe some of these things I'm about to say. I can't really unpack them because we just don't have time for it this morning. But I did think, and maybe some of you might want to do this, I thought over the summer we might take a Sunday night and come up here and have ice cream and just do a Q&A on spiritual gifts. Okay, I don't know how much you got questions on this, but I'd be happy to dive in and explain some of the things that I'm about to say. Maybe we could do that sometime this summer. Here's what I would say. Number one, I would say I think it's possible to make a case from Scripture that certain gifts have ceased. I'm not sure it's an open and shut case. I'm not sure it's a conclusive case. I'm not sure you can say with certainty this is clear in Scripture. But I think you can look at Scripture and say, there's some indication that that's the case. So you see things like 1 Corinthians 13:8 that says, where there is prophecy, it will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be done away with. You see some of this, and it's when the perfect comes. What does that mean? Well, we can get into all of that, but I think you can make a case for the fact, not only from Scripture, but I think from the testimony of the church over the centuries, that some of these gifts were only needed in the first century. Certainly, the office of apostle and prophet, the foundational offices of the church that the church is built on, I don't think we need to go back and keep rebuilding the foundation. So again, I think there's a case that can be made, but at the same time, I don't think it's conclusive. I think those who are cessationists, my word to them is, I think you've got a case, but be really careful not to be too dogmatic about your case. I think some cessationists get so ironclad on this that they try to make it appear as if anybody who holds another view is completely out in left field. I don't think that's the case, because I'm not sure you can make an ironclad argument. I will also say that I do think that the way the gift of tongues is practiced today in our world, in most American churches, that is not what the gift of tongues talked about in the Bible is all about. Certainly not what we saw in the book of Acts, where the gifting of tongues was speaking a known foreign language. And some will argue, well, 1 Corinthians is a different tongue than Acts. Again, we don't have time to get in and explain all the nuances of that. And some will say, well, Acts, the 1 Corinthians tongues, that's the private prayer language. And I say, again, we're back to the whole, how does that edify the church issue? How does your private prayer language benefit the church, which is the purpose of spiritual gifts? So I just don't see that. Now, there may be folks here this morning, you got a private prayer language, okay? That's fine. I don't have heartburn over that. And we can fellowship, and we can talk, we can agree to disagree on that. This is not a dividing line in terms of the church. And sadly, it's been polarizing. I remember first time I met C.J. Mahaney. Some of you know C.J., pastor of a Reformed Charismatic Church. And C.J. would be where Matt Chandler is, and maybe then some, okay? He's a continuationist, and I remember my experience prior to that with charismatics had been more on the Kenneth Hagin variety of the charismatic movement, and there's a lot of error there. So to meet a guy who's got the gospel dead right, I had to kind of rethink my theology. In fact, it changed my eschatology. I thought Jesus must be coming back sooner if this is what's going on, right? And having the opportunity to meet him and to sit down with him and to talk with him and to get some of his teaching on this, to hear what he has to say, to hear his arguments, and to hear how he makes them, and I get his point. I'm still not where he is, and I don't feel like I need to get where he is, and I think he's comfortable with me being where I am. I'm comfortable with him being where he is. And I hope we can do that without being divisive. So even if we say certain gifts have ceased, or even if we say, no, they're still in operation, we should be careful not to let that be a division within the body. Look back at 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and look at how many times it's talked about all, body, one, together. This is Paul's way of saying spiritual gifts should not be dividing, it should be uniting. Spiritual giftedness should be serving one another. And let me say this too. Now listen carefully to this. Even if you say certain gifts have ceased, you should be careful not to be saying that divine healing has ceased. The gift of healing may be gone, but the idea that God's done healing anybody, that's just crazy. Or the gift of miracles may not be present in a person's life today, but the idea that God's not doing miracles, that's crazy talk too. Or the gift of tongues may be gone, but the idea that God might give somebody the ability to speak a foreign language on the field that they need in the moment, of course he can. Those would be miracles. And miracles are different than gifts. And we should not say miracles have ceased, even if we say some gifts have ceased. One last quote from Dr. Lloyd-Jones this morning. This is a good one. He says, if we do believe that these gifts, or most of them, were for the apostolic era only, it does not mean for a moment that no miracles have taken place since. It merely means that the gift of miracles is withdrawn. If you say that the gift of healing has been withdrawn, and that does not mean that you would therefore have to say that no person has ever been healed as a result of the prayers of Christian people. Clearly, throughout history of the church, miracles have taken place. In other words, we must get this clear in our minds. We are discussing these special gifts that were given to attest the authority of the apostles. These special gifts were given at the beginning, but God, being God, can work a miracle whenever he likes and wherever he likes, and he can answer prayer in an unusual manner whenever he chooses to do so. So to say that the gifts were only for that period is not to deny the possibility of miracles now, nor the possibility of marvelous answers to prayer and things which are clearly taught, that clearly belong to the supernatural realm. Okay, we're going to leave it there for today. And like I said, if it'd be helpful, maybe we can get together and do some Q&A over the summer. But I do want to conclude by reminding you that the work of the Holy Spirit, the primary work of the Holy Spirit, it is not gifting. The primary work of the Holy Spirit and all that he does is to point people to Jesus. In fact, I think it's fair to say that if we spend too much time focusing on the Holy Spirit says, stop looking at me, look at Jesus. The Holy Spirit does not want to be in the limelight. The Holy Spirit wants to put Jesus in the limelight. And when we talk about the gifts of God, the greatest gift God has given us is not our spiritual gifts, but it's the gift of Jesus and what he accomplished in the gospel. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave not spiritual gifts, but his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have eternal life. There's a reason why every week we come to the table for bread and juice. We don't come to the table to reflect on our spiritual giftedness. We come to the table to reflect on what Jesus has done for us, the great gift God has given us in Christ and in salvation. God tells us in his word that he so loved the world that he sent his Son, who lived the perfect life, who died the death we deserved, and who then showed that he had the power over death and hell by being resurrected, and who lives today in triumph. And we come each week to say we believe that, to confess that as new, again for us this week, to re-up on the gospel and to say this is primary in our lives. If you're here this morning with us as a visitor, you're welcome at the table as long as you know and love Christ. Everybody who knows and loves Christ is welcome to come and receive from Christ. If you're here this morning and you don't know Christ, maybe a friend brought you, or you're here and this is new to you and you've got questions and you're not sure all that we're talking about here, and rather than coming and receiving bread and juice, I just encourage you to come after the service and let's talk about what God has done for us in Christ. Let's talk about what new life is all about, the greatest gift God's given us. Spiritual gifts aren't the main thing. The gift of eternal life is the main thing. So the way we practice communion here is we'll come down the outer aisles, come through here and receive the elements, come back to your seats through the main aisle, hold on to the elements, and we'll receive them together here in just a minute. You take a minute to prepare your hearts, and then I'll let you know when it's time to come. As you're ready, you may come this morning. Thank you. Jesus wanted to make sure that the gospel would be the main thing for us, and so as he had the Passover meal with his disciples on the night before he was crucified, during the meal he took the bread, and after he had blessed it, he broke it. He said, "This bread is my body, broken for you." They didn't know what he was talking about, but they would see that happen the next day. He said, "As often as you receive this, remember me." His way of saying, make sure the gospel is always the thing that's on your heart and on your lips. And so, Lord Jesus, as we receive this bread this morning, we receive it remembering the sacrifice that you made for us, knowing that we have fellowship with you, that we have been baptized by one Spirit into your body because you paved the way, a new and living way, through your death. And we receive this bread with grateful hearts as we feast on Christ in our heart. Amen. In the same way, after the meal was over, Jesus took the cup, and after he had said a blessing, he passed it. He said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant, the covenant made in my blood, shed for the remission of your sins. As often as you receive this, remember me." And so again, Lord, with this cup, we remember that our sin has been dealt with. The good news that our rebellion is not simply overlooked, but the price is paid. And that you have shed your blood so that we can stand before God with robes of righteousness that you earned for us. We receive this with grateful hearts as we feast on Christ in our heart. Amen. Let's stand and we will sing again the last verse of O Mighty Cross, and then I'll dismiss us with a benediction here. O Mighty Cross, my soul's release, the stripes he bore have brought me peace. His sacrifice on Calvary has made the mighty cross a tree of life. And now the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. The Lord be gracious unto you and give you peace. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. Go in peace. Amen. You are dismissed.
Through the gates of love as fast as I can. I can't wait to see you, cause I'm a desperate man. You made the light and sent it down to show us who you are. Now it's burning.